Ontario's Great Clay Belt Hoax. This short film is based on an article published by me in the Canadian Geographical Journal, January 1975. Prior to 1900, there was not much knowledge of the Clay Belt. A view of northern Ontario would show the Hudson's Bay lowlands and the Precambrian Shield. With the discovery of the Clay Belt around 1900, it became apparent that there was a large tract of fertile land. By 1931, 500 kilometers north of Toronto, there was a scattered patchwork of farms following the government railways, the Ontario Northland and the Canadian National Railways, across the Great Clay Belt. However, during the Great Depression and years thereafter, there's been a steady decline in the number of farms. Rotten log foundations and overgrown fields mark the sites of many failed farms. We will take a look at Ontario's Great Clay Belt Hoax. This map shows the spread of settlement by 1931. The dark areas are quite densely settled areas straightly on the Ontario Northland and the Canadian National Railways. The lighter colors are less densely settled areas. Since 1931, some of the settlement has declined. With the discovery of the Clay Belt around 1900, the provincial government latched onto the concept of a colonization scheme. It was a good way to divert attention from the rapid settlement of the Canadian prairies, and it also provided the market for the Toronto manufacturing industries. ~20 million acres of farmland awaiting the settler. The Kapuskasing and Northern Ontario Railway, built by the Ontario government, heavily promoted settlement on the Clay Belt. Numerous railway brochures spoke of a plain tale of plain people, a very rosy view of pioneer life in New Ontario. It was called New Ontario so people wouldn't be put off by the word northern, meaning cold. Government promoted every conceivable advantage of the north. Even the snow was promoted as being a very pleasant and profitable way to facilitate lumbering, and as a warm blanket to protect winter crops and providing moisture for the crops in the spring. This government brochure speaks of fine farms that are easy to reach and easy to purchase. There's very optimistic opinions from new settlers and a heavy promotion of new opportunities for anyone who wants to make their own life and get ahead. The people promoting the Clay Belt cashed in on a myth that those in the north were somehow stronger, more energized, more progressive and hardy and self-reliant than those to the degenerate south. School Inspector J.B. McDougall, for instance, wrote, "And build ye a race, toil-bred sons of the Northland, as your stately pines straight, as your granite hills strong, thew-knit, supple sinewed, soul and body puissant." A popular song in Cochrane in 1912 went like this: "This town had its birth about 3 years ago. in the cold winter months and some 6 feet of snow. It grew strong and hardy as winter babies grow, though 'twas born in the winter in some 6 feet of snow. Snow, snow, in the lap of the snow. It grew strong and hardy, though born in the snow. Photos and government reports made the area look like a real adventure for the new settler. Jobs were said to be easy to come by. There was always the timber industry and the mining industry. In terms of fertility, the government went overboard. New Ontario was a Garden of Eden, the new Canaan, where cattle clover is a weed 3 feet, 3 inches in height. No soils were superior. Turnips would weigh up to 40 pounds. Timothy was 6 feet high, cabbages 3 feet high, and radishes over 2 feet high. Pictures seem to support this view of the tremendous fertility of the soil. The first settlement is a very rough-hewn house, but reports indicated that farmers within a year or two were building substantial dwellings. This government reports that this is the settler's first attempt at home building. A bit hard to believe. These settlers look very happy. This is the sort of barn and home you could expect after 10 years of work. Pictures like these were very appealing. Settlers work together, the report said. You help other people build their barns and they help you build yours. During the Depression years, immigration faltered and settlement began to decline. In the 1940s and 50s, the number of farmers had become fewer and fewer and farmers much larger. It was found that frequent frosts, late frosts in the spring, early frosts in the autumn, frequently killed the crops. It was enormously costly to till the heavy soil. Ironically, the clay soil is tremendously fertile. Many young men wasted many valuable years of their lives trying to farm, only to be driven away by the hardships. Thank you, viewer, for joining me on this brief tour of settlement in the great clay belt of Northern Ontario.